It's just you.
It's because we know and believe that we can make a difference. It's time to step in, to lead boldly, and to lead courageously.
How we use our power is the measure of our leadership. Great leaders use power to empower other people.
Nobody can be you the way that you can be you. Your authenticity is your distinct competitive advantage.
Legacy, my darling leaders, is a story about you that is yet to be written, but for which you hold the pen.
Intentionally grow every day so that you will have capacity for more, more, and more before. If you're still excited about what you did 5 years ago, you're not growing.
You need to think beyond your means. Dream something so amazing and so ridiculous that it gets you out of your comfort zone and it scares you to death.
What instincts do is instincts allow you to pursue the possibilities instead of just protecting the probabilities.
When we become successful in organizations, you know, sometimes comfort becomes more important than improvement.
You have difficult conversations. They are simply part of being human, and how you handle those conversations defines your leadership.
We are in desperate need of culturally intelligent leaders who are not fearful of difference, but who will lean into it and say, "Help me understand what's going on here."
I learned such a crucial lesson, which is it's completely irrelevant who's right and who's wrong. The only relevant thing is the customer must always feel heard.
If you want to be a success, identify a human need and reach out to solve it.
Be relentless in what it is that you want to achieve, but not inflexible to how you want to get there.
There's no such thing as winning business. There's no such thing as winning life. Infinite games are a part of our existence. The problem is, most of us don't know how to lead in an infinite game. The only true competitor in an infinite game is yourself.
Your faith is not a way out of your courage. It is not a way around your sacrifice. Your faith is the strength and the fuel to step into your pain and into your fear and into your failures.
Your life is too valuable, your calling too great, your God too good to waste your life on things that do not last. You are a leader. Go do what leaders do with God's help and by God's power. Leaders change the world.
That is the Global Leadership Summit, so don't miss out on that. Go online and book your tickets today. There are venues all over the Durban area that you can attend it at. But tonight you're at Grace Family Church, uMhlanga PM service. So welcome to those of you who are here joining us online. We're so glad that you're here too. My name is Jess, and I just want to kick off this time together by inviting you to stand. We are going to worship. We're going to give our time, our attention, our focus to God. Let's start like that.
This whole world can hold me.
Christ who lives within me, Christ who lives within me. From beginning to the end, you deserve the glory, you deserve the glory.
Thank you.
you've done for me.
Oceans for your greatness.
About the song is that it tells us the story of God, the story of creation, the story of the Word made flesh, the incarnation of Christ, that Jesus is with us. And then it tells the story of the recreation, that every single one of us, Jesus died to save, and that He is recreating us, renewing us, rebirthing us as God's creation. And tonight we're going to take some time for communion, which tells this very same story. The story that Jesus became the Word became flesh, that Jesus shed His body and His blood. Why? So that we could step into the story of recreation. That God would renew us, rebirth us, reform who we are in His likeness. And we take communion again and again and again, and we'll do it 100 billion times, because every single time we drink from the cup and we eat the broken bread, we are reminded that Christ in us is the hope of glory. That Christ in us is the hope of new life, of reformation, of grace, of another chance and another chance and another chance, 100 billion times over. So in this moment, won't you go to one of the tables that's lit up near you, take a cup, take a piece of cracker bread, go back to your seats, and we're going to take communion together as we remind ourselves that Christ is in us, reshaping, reforming, and renewing. Sit, you can stand, whatever feels more comfortable for you, but let's take this bread. And as we eat it, won't you say these words, Christ in me, the hope of glory. And as you eat it, I want you to think of the hope. The hope that maybe you feel you've lost. The hope that maybe is kind of ebbing away. And to know that whatever is broken is restored in Christ. Whatever feels old is renewed in Christ. Whatever where you feel despair, we have Christ in us, the hope of glory. And let's reflect on that. Let's meditate and chew on that as we eat tonight. As we drink from this cup, we remember Christ's blood poured out for us. And we remember that Jesus pours his Spirit into us again and again and again, that the Holy Spirit renews us every day, that the Holy Spirit fills us over and over again, bringing hope, bringing peace, bringing guidance. Won't you say it with me now? Christ in me, the hope of glory. Let's drink together. God, we thank you not only that you created us in your image, but wherever that image has been marred or broken, wherever there is despair or hopelessness, you renew, you restore, you bring back to life, and you pour your love and your grace into us over and over again, 100 billion times over, God. You will never stop pouring out your love for us. Won't you stand as we sing together in closing?
Chase down my heart through all of my failures and pride. And on the hill you created, light of the world, abandoned in darkness to die. But as you disappear. like you would again 100 billion times. But what measure could amount to your desire? You're the one who never leaves the one behind. You're the one who never leaves the one behind. Yes, you're the one who never leaves the one behind.
God, we thank you for your faithfulness to us, expressed again and again in creation, in scripture, in these gatherings that we have. We remember who you are and we worship you. We thank you that we get to participate in this story where you speak to us, you guide us, and we can come alive in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Won't you take your seats? Welcome, everybody. Welcome to those of you who are joining us online. We hope you feel like you're connected, you belong, and that you're part of this community. And if you don't, if you're kind of wondering what the next step is for you to kind of engage with Grace Family Church as your spiritual home, then won't you come tomorrow night to engage too? We are having a dessert evening. It's an opportunity for you to kind of get the behind-the-scenes story on this church and who we are, what we value, what our vision is, and how you can get plugged in. You can sign up afterwards. But we would love to know you and for you to know us and this be a place that's more than just Sundays. Now, we're going to get ready to take up the tithes and the offerings. And while I was preparing for this part of the service, I had this verse, Proverbs 3, kind of on my heart. And as I started reading it, I realized that this can be such a powerful moment of surrender when we give. Because God calls us not to give out of obligation, not to give for any other reason other than to kind of exercise the trust and the surrender that is required for our walk with God. I think so many of us would love God to guide us, would love God to speak to us. But in order for us to be responsive to that, there have to be these moments of surrender. And this is one of those moments. Let me read this to you. This is from Proverbs 3. It's in the Message version. It sounds really fresh to our ears. Trust God from the bottom of your heart. Don't try to figure out everything on your own. Listen for God's voice in everything you do, everywhere you go. He's the one who will keep you on track. Don't assume you know it all. Run to God, run from evil. Your body will glow with health. Your very bones will vibrate with life. Honor God with everything you own. Give him the first and the best. When we give, it's an act of trust. It's an act of running to God. It's a way of saying, you know what? I don't know it all. You're the one who keeps me on track. So as you give tonight, won't you let that be part of your practice of honoring God with your first and your best so that you can be responsive to his guidance and his voice. Let's pray as we get ready to pass the baskets around. God, we thank you that you do have our best interests at heart, that you do have a great story for us to step into, a calling and a purpose for our lives. And we don't want to become numb to that. We don't want to be desensitized to that. And in these moments of giving, it kind of awakens us, even jolts us out of our comfort zone to notice what you're doing in our lives, to surrender to you, to trust you, to believe that you're the one who keeps us on track. We thank you for this tonight, Jesus, as we give with gratitude and thanksgiving. Amen. So last week we asked for some volunteers. We're looking for team members for Grace Kids at this service, at the uMhlanga PM service. I chatted to Lauren, our kids' church pastor, in the week, and she was telling me that 5 people came and picked up application forms. So that's amazing. If you had one of those application forms, please fill it out and get it back to Lauren. But we need more people. We're looking for 10 people. So if you are able to give one or two Sundays of the month to serving the next generation of Grace Family Church, for investing into their lives for 1 hour a week along with a team of others, then please go speak to Lauren after the service. And then Christina is going to let us know a little bit about what's happening next around here at Grace. And Paul Rowney is preaching a cracker of a sermon tonight. It's the second part in How to Cure a Zombie. And Paul is literally going to tell us how to cure zombies tonight. I know you're on the edge of your seat already, but he's almost up here. So just hang on as Christina lets us know what's going on.
Hi everyone, I'm Christina and welcome to Grace Family Church. We have one quick announcement for the parents, so listen up as we tell you what's happening at Grace Kids. Our Grace Kids team have another fantastic series starting today. For our primary group, it's called Angry Words, and for pre-primary, it's called Careful Little Tongue. Through this series, they will look at the power of words whilst encouraging your children to think before they speak, using their words to build people up and not to hurt them. Parents, don't forget to grab a Faith at Home card at the Grace Kids registration desk so you can be part of the adventure too. Each week, we update our website, app, and social media pages with info about what's happening at Grace. So make sure you're connected with us there. If you're looking for a group to be part of, then you can go ahead and sign up on our website too. It's so great to have you with us today. Enjoy the rest of the service.
I want to start this zombie talk with a question. A question that hopefully you will be able to hold on to as we enter into this time of discussion. A question that hopefully you will be able to resolve for yourself at the end of our time together. And it's this question. I hope it is something that you're able to hold on to. What steps do you need to take to be fully alive as you pursue your purpose? And for some of you, my encouragement is to think of the step that you need to take tomorrow. For some of you, I'm so aware that some of you are facing a decision that you need to make in your life now. And our hope during our time together is that you'll be able to have that question answered. What steps do you need to take in order to head in the right direction and to become fully alive? So we're in this series called How to Cure a Zombie. And last week, Jess kicked us off with this quote. And this really is at the heart of why we're doing this series. It says, "The glory of God is humanity fully alive." But so often, we go through our days like zombies. You're preparing for tomorrow with the sure sight that you're just going to get through tomorrow and then get through Tuesday and then get through the week and then Saturday. Or better yet, Friday night, late Saturday morning, Saturday night. How do we cure this zombie-like nature that's so present in our society today? How do we actively pursue our purposes and become fully alive? So last week, Jess explored this idea of career versus calling. And the line that she said last week was so great is that calling is about our character, not our credentials. I really do want to encourage you, if you weren't here last week, go online, go onto our app, listen to last week's sermon. It will give you so much context, and I know it will encourage you. But this week, I want to get somewhat more practical, and I want to give you three tools that will help you make a call around your calling. See what I did there? Should I say it again? I'd like to give you three tools by the end of our time together that are going to help you make a call around your calling. If you're making a decision, if you're wanting to know what step do I take next, I hope that during our time together, you'll be equipped to do that. Some of you are sitting here, and this is my thought to you. If your job is ever going to be more than just a job, I hope that tonight answers some of that. For some of you here tonight, you're sitting in a position, you're sitting in a job going, "What? I know I need to take a next step, but what is that next step?" I hope that we can answer some of that tonight and how you do that. For some of you, you're sitting here in a zombie-like job, and I hope that tonight we'll be able to equip you. These tools will be able to help you to find life and life to the full in what you're doing. My real hope is that we'll be able to cure the zombie. But in order to do that, in order to make the right call, if our job is ever going to be more than just a job, if we're going to find purpose and meaning and significance in what we're doing, we have to ask the right questions. If we're ever going to be able to live this out properly, we need to be able to ask the right questions. And ultimately, this comes down to the difference between decision-making and discernment. This comes down to the difference between decision-making and discernment. And that is what tonight is about. I hope that we'll be able to, together, in our time together, answer those questions that I set tonight up with, and that together we'll discover the difference between decision-making and discernment. You see, decision-making is often based on questions that have the end goal as the focus. So often when we're making decisions, we make decisions with the end goal, with the intention as the focus. And so when it comes to questions around our career, we ask similar type of questions. We ask questions like, which career will earn me the most money as the end goal? We ask questions around our career that say, which job or which step within the career that I'm currently in is going to earn me the most respect from my peers? We ask questions like, you know, I want to accumulate the most wealth in the shortest amount of time and have the most flexibility, and so what decisions do I need to make in order to do that? It's the end goal that we have in our mind. Now, these questions, these decision-making questions ultimately come down to questions of our identity. Almost nothing more shapes our identity than the question of what do you do? In our society today, I'd say one of the biggest things that shapes our identity is our career. That's why when you meet someone new for the first time, the first thing they ask is, what do you do? And so because of that reality, we have this insatiable desire to have a career that gives us prominence amongst our peers. We want to say, I do this or I do that. These are the decisions that I've made that have got me to a place, and this is the identity that I stand in. But here's the challenge for us, and it's the challenge that Jess laid out before us. We don't find our identity in our career. We find our identity in Christ. And it's in a journey in order to discover how we do that. Ultimately, so often, the challenge with decision-making, with the end goal in focus, is that the questions we ask are questions that are ultimately focused on us, on me, on what I'm going to get out of it, and what I need as the end goal, and what I want to have. The decision-making questions we ask are the what questions. What will I get? Discernment, however, and this is what we want to engage in tonight, discernment is about asking the questions behind the questions. Discernment is the ability to ask the questions behind the questions. It's the why questions. Now, let me tell you why this matters. Why it matters that we engage in decisions with discernment as opposed to decision making. You see, when it comes to decision making, as I've said, we make decisions based on the end goal. We want success, we want money, we want prominence, and so we make decisions in our lives that we think are going to get us there. Our intentions drive our decisions, but here's the reality. It's not our intentions that define the end goal, it's the path that we go on. Andy Stanley says it like this: it is direction, not intention, that will determine your destination. So often we use our intentions, what we want at the end, to be the focus, to be the lens that we look at decisions with. But the encouragement is to have a discernment that helps us ask the questions behind the questions. And when we're able to discern, we're able to discover the path. When we're able to ask the questions behind the questions, we're able to head in the right direction. And it matters because our direction determines our destination, not the intentions that we have. It's these why questions that help us do that. So, in our time together, what I'd like to do is to give you some tools that will help you discern, to help you move away from decision-making focused on your intentions and discern pathways that lead to life. The first tool that I want to give us tonight, and I've sort of alluded to it earlier, is that in order to discern, we need to ask good questions. And I want to give you three questions tonight that I hope will be able to help you discern what the next step is that you need to take, whatever it is that you're facing. These three questions I've got from an author called Jared Rowney. He's a great writer. He wrote a brilliant book around this whole thing. And the first question is this. It seems quite obvious, but it's a good question. If we're going to discern where we need to go, the first thing we need to do is ask good questions. And the first question is this: what am I passionate about? In Genesis, it's clear that God created for the pure joy of creation, of the ability to create. He out of joy, expressed purpose. And we, you and I, are molded in his image. Isaiah 64 verse 8 says this, "We are the clay, and you, God, are the potter. We are all formed by your hand." One of the ways that God molds us into the people he wants us to be, one of the ways that God gives us the ability to discern the way that we should go, is to ask the question about, what am I passionate about? You may be sitting here going, I'm passionate about retail. I'm passionate about launching my own business. I'm passionate about nonprofits. I'm passionate about blockchain. I'm passionate about education. These things are amazing, and they are the starting point to discovering your calling. When we start to unlock the things that we're passionate about, we begin the journey of discovering what God has called us to do. Now, here's the challenge. Passion without competence is worthless. Passion without competence is worthless. That's why the second question that I think we need to ask when it comes to discerning the way we should go is what gifts has God given me? What gifts has God given me? Writing to the early church in Rome, the Apostle Paul says this, in his grace, not because of who you are or how good you think you are. And just a side note, you may be sitting here tonight going, hey, you don't know me, you don't know that I don't have gifts. You need to listen to what's about to be said here. In his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. We have largely, I think, ignored this verse in our world today when it comes to understanding our calling. Oftentimes, we say that our calling is only linked to what we're passionate about. But what this verse is encouraging us to engage with is that we find our calling when our passion and our giftings intersect. Let me give you an example like this. I love surfing. I really love surfing. And in fact, in some ways, I'm passionate about it, which is why I bought this cool surfer t-shirt. I nearly wore a cap and board shorts, but that's too much. I really love it. There was definitely a season when the weather was good and the sort of, you know, Durban was cooking, that I would be out with a good mate of mine. We'd be surfing. When the weather was good, we were out there. I loved it. I love the feeling of freedom. I love the connection to the ocean. And if you were to say to me, do you think that surfing could be your career? I'd say, I'm definitely passionate about it. And I could definitely see myself touring the world and surfing amazing spots. But here's the challenge. Out of all the mornings that I would go out of all the waves that I'd paddle for, 2 out of 20 were the ones that I'd catch. And if I'm honest, I was genuinely rubbish at surfing. You see, we can be passionate about certain things, but calling is found at the intersection between passion and gifting. For some of us, that's a challenge because you've been told what you're passionate about, go and do. Ask yourself, where does my passion intersect my gifting? And in order to do that, sometimes we need other people to say, you think you can sing, don't go to idols. Some of us need to listen to the challenging words of our parents. Some parents are saying, amen. Some of us need to listen to our spouse who says, I love that you're passionate about blockchain, but challenge. I just feel like for some of us, our world is telling us that you can pursue whatever you're passionate about and it will lead to success. Yes, it's true. Pursue things, but ask the question of yourself, where does it intersect with my gifting? Now I want to say this. If you have a gifting around a particular thing, my encouragement to you is to do that thing to the best of your absolute ability. If you're a carpenter, Brandon, that's you. Do make the best tables that you can possibly make. In fact, all of you should go to Republic. Brandon's in my small group. He's made all the furniture. It's amazing. Bro, you're doing an incredible thing. Pursue the gifting that God has placed on your life to make amazing furniture. This is one of them. Come on. Now, can we just clap for Brandon? That's amazing. He makes awesome wooden things. If you're a student, study to the best of your ability. If you're a full-time mom, do the best you can and be present when you can and love like no one else can. Gifting is the ability to express fully what God has placed in you. And I think this, Tim Keller says this, we have a ministry of competence. We have a ministry of competence. This is the fact that when we can, with full competence, live out what God has gifted us to do, we will have a ministry to those around us. when you do what only you can do, as well as only you can do it, you will bring glory to God and inspire the people around you. We need a world where people are saying, I know what I'm gifted to do, I know what I'm passionate about, and I'm going to pursue that thing. There's an encouragement for someone here tonight, and I felt that I needed to say this. For some of you, you're scared to step out. Be bold. God will provide. Ask the question, where does my gifting meet my passion? Where is that intersection? Now, some of you don't have the luxury, perhaps, to ask that kind of question. And I acknowledge that. For some of you sitting here, you're saying, you know, family, security, I need to provide. I've got expectations. I understand that. And maybe you're in a job where you don't feel like your passion and your gifting are meeting, but ask yourself this question. In the job that you're in, where could you start expressing gifting and passion? And watch the way that that changes your week. Now these two things, I think, are somewhat present, and I think that they hopefully make sense. Ask that question. But I really believe that the third question that you and I can ask is the question that has the potential to unlock our purpose and calling and meaning in our lives. It's a question that I genuinely believe allows us the ability to move away from living our weeks like zombies, and it's this question. Where do I have the greatest opportunity to love others? Where do I have? You're facing a decision in your job, or you're wanting to know what kind of job you should do? Ask this question. Where do you have the greatest opportunity to love others? Because here's the reality. There is a paradox in purpose. There's a paradox in purpose. If we want to find our lives, we must lose them. If we want to gain, we must give. Jesus says it like this. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you will save it. And whatever you do, and what you do, sorry, let me read that again. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world and you lose your soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? Time and time again, it is abundantly clear that we find our lives when we lose them. That we find joy when we love others. When we make our lives not about ourselves, but other people, we find purpose and meaning and significance. For some of you, you're in a career, and this is going to revolutionize the way that you engage in the work that you do. Asking this question, what do I do in order to love other people? This question has the ability to change the way we engage with the decisions we make. And I know this. When we ask this question, we will find ourselves in places where we are able to love people, but in return, find purpose and meaning. And I really believe this, that we will be able to become fully alive. So we need to ask good questions. Let's ask the question of what are we passionate about? What are we gifted for? Where do those two things meet? And what decisions can I make that's going to place me in the best position to love others around me? The first tool that we have is to ask good questions. The second tool is this. When it comes to discerning the right step that you should take, the second tool is seeking wisdom. It's wisdom. When it comes to discernment, wisdom is the ability to look at what's in front of you from another perspective. It's the ability, and true wisdom is the ability to look at what's in front of you from God's perspective. If you're facing a tough decision, if you need to take another step in the career that you're in, or are wanting to know what to do with your life, seek God's wisdom. I love what James 1:5 says this. If you need wisdom, ask our generous God, and he will give it to you. Pray for God to give you wisdom, and then listen. Listen. Slow down. Reflect. Seek wisdom. The other part of this is that we seek God's wisdom not just through prayer and silence, but through asking those around us. I love this verse, Proverbs 11:14. Without wise leadership, a nation falls. There is safety in having many advisors. Another way it says, other translations say, without wise counsel. Some of you know my story. When I was in a stage of my life where I was making decisions and I was trying to like figure out what I should do with my allotted years, whatever those were, just after school, I was clear on two things. I knew two things to be true. The first thing, this is just after school, the first thing that I was fairly clear on is that I didn't want to become a pastor. And the second thing that I was pretty clear on is that I really didn't want to move to Durban. I was living in Joburg at the time. That's fun. Here I am. I'm also very clear of my future. I'm going to do ministry in the Bahamas. If anyone wants to come and join me, you're welcome to. But I was fairly clear on those two things. I didn't want to become a pastor in myself, and I didn't want to move to Durban. And then this opportunity at Grace came up to be a pastor in Durban, and I was fairly certain I knew the answer to that question. I knew what I was going to say. But I thought, you know, I may as well engage in some level of discernment here. And so I sort of tried to seek what God's wisdom was on the matter. I sought the wisdom of those that I trusted around me. And I started to ask those three questions. And as I engaged in that process of discernment, it became clear to me that this was the right step. I think for some of us, we need to be able to seek the wisdom of others because it really helps define our purpose and our calling. Now, I want to say this at this point. In order to seek wisdom from wise people. Some of us are seeking wisdom from the wrong places. And here's a little tip. How do you know if you're finding wisdom in the right place? It's this. If the person has your best interests at heart, but is willing to challenge you, that's a good person to ask for discernment from. Because sometimes we go to people who just say, no, that thing that you love doing, do it. You're amazing. You're the best person ever. But you know you can't sing, so don't enter idols. We need people who have our backs but are willing to challenge us. This is how we seek the wisdom of others. Seek wisdom. The third tool. The first one, let's ask good questions. The second tool, let's seek wisdom. And the third tool is peace. If we're going to move away from decision-making focused on the goal at the end and often focused on ourselves, and we're going to move into a place where we make calls around our career based on discernment, a huge thing when it comes to this is peace. If you've been around Christians for any length of time, if you've been a Christian for any length of time, you have definitely said or heard these words, no, I just felt peace about my decision. Anyone said that? I've said that countless times, and I've heard it many, many more. We so often say, no, I'm making this decision because I feel at peace about it. But here's the thing. When it comes to discernment, and I want to say this lightly, I want to create space for this to settle with you where it needs to settle with you. When it comes to discerning what God wants for your life, peace is not about a good feeling, but about a clear conviction. When it comes to discerning what God's calling is for your life, peace is not about a good feeling, but about a clear conviction. So often, I have made, and maybe you have too, I have made decisions in my life because they felt right to me in the moment, or because I believed that they were going to make me feel the best in the long run. We so often make decisions based on peace because it feels good in the moment. Have you done that? Have you had that moment? And I think here's the thing. When it comes to peace as a tool for discernment, what we often want when it comes to peace, sorry, as a decision-making tool, we want peace to be the starting line. We have a decision in front of us, and so we seek God, and we say, God, give me peace about this decision, and we want it to be the starting line. But what I've realized as I've looked through scriptures and as I've looked at people's lives that inspire me and the world around me, what I see is this, is that peace is not the starting line. Peace is the companion. So often we want peace at the beginning, but what God's actually calling you to isn't comfortable. And we want that good feeling up front, but God's saying, no, that's not what peace is. Peace is when you live out clear conviction, and peace is companion. Peace is the companion when we move into these spaces. You see, true calling is not found in comfort, but in conviction. And oftentimes, conviction isn't comfortable. I want to share just a quick story with you about a friend, two friends of mine, so two stories actually. The first one is of a friend who was in Joburg, and he was in a job that he didn't fully enjoy and fully love. And he was given an opportunity to have his dream job here in Durban. Him and his wife were wanting to live by the sea for many, many years. It was like their dream. And so he was offered this opportunity. Now, everything wasn't good where he was, and he was offered everything that he'd ever wanted. And he engaged in this process of discernment, and he sought God's conviction for his life. And through prayer and through seeking the wisdom of others, he felt that the conviction was that he needed to stay. To stay in a job that he didn't love, in a city he didn't want to be in. And for 3 years, he pursued that same conviction with incredible obedience. For some of us, we don't like that idea. But what I know of his story is this, is that that peace was his companion throughout the journey. Another friend of mine in his late 40s was in a job that he absolutely loved. And not only did he love this job, he had absolute security. They provided housing, a housing allowance. He had a great salary. Not just those things. It also had a very clear career path. He knew where he was going to go, and he knew the opportunities ahead of him. And in many ways, he felt like this could be the place, the job that he ended his career. This could be the place where he ended his working life. And so he was very secure there. But after a few years, he began to become aware that the environment he was in was turning a blind eye to discrimination and racial prejudice. And he had to make the decision in that moment about what he was going to do. He had to ask God for a clear conviction about what to do in that moment when he discovered what was going on. And so with conviction, he stood up for what he knew was wrong, and he was absolutely slated for it. He was shunned, he was isolated, he was mocked by his peers, because with conviction he made a decision. But he had peace. At the end of this thing, he had to, with conviction, make a call about his career, and he actually made the call to leave that job and go back to studying in his late 40s, studying about how he can use his passion and his gifting to see racial transformation happen in his field of expertise. You see, here's the thing about conviction. Conviction doesn't always lead to a way out. And conviction doesn't always lead to an easy decision. Often the path of conviction is trial and challenge. But always the companion is peace. And if we want to live a life of meaning and purpose and significance, we need to stop running towards comfort and we need to start running towards conviction. Our world needs people who are living with conviction. Your life will change where you start engaging with the world around you with the lens of conviction and not the lens of comfort. It's tough. Here's the beautiful truth. True conviction lived out is peace. You'll find peace when you live that space out. I want to end our time together with an opportunity for you to discern. I want to end our time together with a moment to slow down, to reflect, to perhaps for some of you pause. I want to create a space where we can ask good questions, seek wisdom, and find peace. Find peace as a companion. See, if we're going to move away from living life like zombies, and if we're going to move into a space where we're able to be fully alive to the glory of God, we need to discern about the next steps. And I know some of you have them. And they're scary. I know for some of you, what I've spoken about tonight around comfort and conviction is challenging you. And I want to enter into a space where we sit with some of that. And I want to share a prayer with you. A prayer that I hope will speak to you. And so if anything I have said tonight has stirred something up in you, if anything I've said tonight has said there's something there for you, I want this prayer, these words to be yours. So as you watch this video, allow this prayer to be your prayer. And then after the video, I'm going to come back up and we're just going to ask those three questions together again. So let's engage in this video. Let it be our prayer. Allow these words to be your words. Thank you. Do not fear, for God is with you. And the decisions that you have to make, and I hope tonight with some level of discernment, you would know that you do not need to be afraid about what lies ahead, for God is with you. If you're in a job where you feel like it's a dead end, do not fear, God is with you. If you're faced with a career decision that's overwhelming, do not fear, God is with you. If you're uncertain about your future because you don't know whether there's a job waiting for you at the end of your degree, do not fear, God is with you. If the markets that you're invested in are not going well, do not fear, God is with you. And part of the way that we discover our calling and live that out and find life is through discernment. So here's what I'd love us to sit with just a moment. These words, they're going to come up onto the screen. Engage with what you need to engage with now. So what you see on the screen, you respond to, whatever that is. So let us discern for a moment together. Which of those are your words? Which of those is your prayer? For some of you, you need to ask good questions. For some of you, you need to seek wisdom about the decision that you're about to make. For some of you, you're about to make a decision based on peace as the starting line, and you don't have clear conviction. Seek clear conviction, and peace will be your companion. And my hope for us as a community is that as we discern our life's calling, we would bring glory to God and become fully alive. That as we discern our life's calling, we would bring glory to God and become fully alive. God does not want you wandering through this world like a zombie. God wants you to become fully alive. So won't you discern? Won't you discern about the steps you need to take? Because it is our direction, not our intention, that determines our destination. Let's pray together. God, help each of us here tonight. Help us to discern. Help us to discern what you want us to do with the job we're in, with the job we're heading to, with the career that we're dreaming of, with the fear that's before us. Help us to discern. I pray for a peace for all of us, God, that would surpass all understanding, that is in us because you, Christ, are in us. And I thank you that because you're in us, you give us the courage to have conviction. And so, God, I pray for all seated here tonight and those that call this place home and beyond, that we would be a people that are fully alive to your glory. Jesus, we commit ourselves to this endeavor, to this adventure. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Amen. My hope is that you join us again next week as we engage in a series called Classics, looking at some fundamental truths of our faith. I'd love to see you here next week. Hang out, grab a coffee, grab some food, and we'd love to connect with you at any stage. God bless.